Thanks for stopping by Auto Technic. Today, we need to do a little maintenance on my 2001 M5. Hang tight. Okay, so what we have on the docket is we have a little check engine light issue on this car that we need to address. So what I have to do is I need to go ahead and get an exhaust cam sensor replaced on this car. And really, it's just the one sensor, the exhaust cam sensor on bank two. And I'm gonna go ahead and walk you guys through the steps on what it's gonna take to go ahead and get this cam sensor out. Okay, a couple things. I've replaced countless cam sensors on S62s and E39 M5s, but caveat to that, I did all that when I was a BMW technician, and that was back from 2001 to 2011. So it's been a really long time since I've done this job. So we're just gonna dive in off memory and see what I can do, see how it goes. Another thing that I want to cover is my approach whenever doing any repair like this is I am a big believer of taking stuff off to make the job easier. Even though removing some items, the plenum, boxes, possibly the valve cover, that is more work removing those items, but I've always found it for myself, it's easier to remove those items, those easy to remove items, to go ahead and get access to the more difficult things like the cam sensor. I'm gonna start this process by getting the microfilter and air inlet housing off. I'm gonna get the air plenum off, the lower case, and I'm gonna take the coil cover. And then we're gonna go ahead and kind of see how much room I have back there to see the back of the cylinder head and see what else I'm going to remove to get this cam sensor out. Also, one thing I wanna cover, if you guys have a S62, an E39, or really a BMW in general, cam sensors are a chronic problem. Normally, I would go ahead and diagnose to be sure that I have a bad sensor, check signals, check powers and grounds and wires. But honestly, when it comes to a BMW and a cam sensor fault, I don't even bother. Throw a cam sensor in. If you have a reoccurring issue after that, then you might want to look at other things. On the S62 in particular, do be careful because you can have Vanos issues that can cause cam sensor faults. Also, my Vanos units have been rebuilt, so I'm confident they're good. And I know from the faults that I have camshaft signal and cam correlation faults. That's letting me know that the sensor's bad. So that's the reason why I'm diving in without diagnosing this. Other cars, I would do a little bit more diagnosing before jumping in, but I've learned with these BMWs, this is their Achilles heels. Cooling systems, cam sensors.
Now, you don't necessarily need to remove all these items to get the cam sensor out, and you can certainly do it with leaving the plenum on. My train of thought is that it's easier to remove those items and have extra space and freedom to move your hands and work in the area, rather than save the time by not removing those items and then you're just fighting in a smaller space. Having that extra space and freedom to work and move around while doing the repair, I find it to be much less frustrating than working in a smaller space, and I also find that I have less chance of damaging or breaking other components while I'm trying to work in there.
Removing more is less work. I'm a firm believer in that. So you can see that I went ahead and removed the microfilter box, air inlet, air plenum, both air boxes, left side coil cover, and just the rear coil. I left the other three front coils in. So if we look over here, we can look back in the engine. Let's see if I can get a flashlight back here. And right there, you can see the exhaust cam sensor. So it's a little tight. You can see that I have the complete wire harness for the coils unbolted and moved away. And that's given me enough. It's given me enough to go ahead and move this rubber out of the way, which then frees up all of my access down to the back to the cam sensor. So that's an Allen head that we need to go ahead. I think it's a 5 mil. It's gonna be pretty tight to get to it, but I have a really good tool for that I'm gonna show you. Now, another thing, if you guys are looking closely, yep. This car, I do have the bored out diamond throttles and velocity stacks. For those of you with a keen eye, probably noticed that already. This is not an S2 car. This is just a regular car that the previous owner was able to buy those parts individually. I still have the factory throttles, so I might make another video showing the difference of the factory throttle versus these bored out diamond throttles and the diamond velocity stack, so keep an eye on the channel. Okay, to get the cam sensor out is what I'm gonna go to is this little toolkit here, which I would even recommend this for the average home hobbyist. It's a little Matco kit and it's a small reach kit. And you can see here the part number is SBIT31. This is extremely handy little kit. So it has this small little ratcheting wrench that I can use for these bit drivers. So you can see how stubby that Allen is versus a standard. You pull a standard one out here for you. So you can see the size difference of those two Allens. And then when you go ahead and insert it into this ratchet, very small, helps out quite a bit. Also on this kit, you have all these shallow sockets and they fit into the larger end. It works great for tight space. Plus they have your normal quarter inch adapter, so you can still run them on a normal extension and socket. But this tool, I think I paid probably about $100 for this Matco kit, and I use it all the time. This one is metric. I'm not sure if they have one in standard, but it is really my go-to. And this is what I'm going to use to reach down there and get that cam sensor out. And is what I plan on doing is I plan on going and unbolting the cam sensor while it's still connected to the wire harness. And then there's going to be enough slack in that wire harness that it's going to allow me to go ahead and disconnect it. And then I'll do the reverse on the installation of the cam sensor. So I need to set the camera down and let's go ahead and get this cam sensor out.
With my Matco stubby ratchet kit, I had plenty of space actually to get back there and work out the 5mm Allen bolt that holds in the cam sensor. My biggest concern while working back there is I didn't have a lot of space to actually get my hands or fingers onto the bolt to remove it, and I really wanted to be sure that I did not drop that bolt down into the abyss and create a bunch more work for myself.
All right, pretty easy, got the bolt out, and you can see that I took the harness here and pulled this cam sensor up. So now I don't have to worry about disconnecting it while it's down in the back of the head. It's a lot easier to do it this way, where I can just go ahead and disconnect the sensor like so, and then I can just plug the new sensor in, insert it in the head. And the hardest part about this job on this cam sensor is getting the bolt out. I have to basically run it with my fingers real carefully and just the tips of my fingers to pull it out so I don't drop it. Now, normally, this would be a great time to be doing the intake cam sensor as well, but there's none available at the moment. They're on back order everywhere else. Normally, I just would have went ahead and ordered a cam sensor and replaced both on that bank while I'm here, but since they're not available, I just went ahead and ordered the one that is available so I can get my check engine light taken care of. And not if, but when that cam sensor fails on the intake side, I'll be back to replace that as well. So what I need to do from here is it's time just to go ahead and take that cam sensor, get the new one installed, and reverse the order of operations. Now, I sourced my new camshaft sensor from FCP Euro, and I did that because A, you can get the OEM manufacturer sensor much cheaper than the factory sensor, and also their lifetime warranty. So the manufacturer of the sensor is VNE, and they are actually the ones that go ahead and manufacture them for BMW. Now, this is the old one, and here's the new one. Quite a bit of difference, because clearly it's gone through an update over the years. But if you look carefully on this sensor, you can see right there where they actually have to go and grind the BMW mark and the part number off the sensor to be able to sell it under their own label. So this sensor is actually half the price of the BMW sensor, but it's the same part. A while back, I replaced the radiator in this car, ordered a Molly radiator for it, or as a bear. And anyways, it was a complete identical, and I actually have good footage showing where they ground the BMW part mark off that radiator as well. So that's one good thing to keep in mind, especially with FCP Euro. You get a good warranty that they give you on all the parts, but also a lot of the stuff is OEM at a fraction of the price just because it doesn't have the mark. So I need to go ahead and get this new sensor put in, reverse the order of operations, and we'll close this up.
Now for reassembly, we're naturally going to go ahead and reverse all the steps we took for disassembly. One thing that you might notice here is when I disassembled this, I did use power tools, mainly a little quarter inch drive electric impact driver and a cordless ratchet. And if you have a keen eye here, you'll notice that I'm assembling everything by hand. Now that's something that I developed over the years. When I was much younger and just starting my career, I did use a lot of power and battery tools reassembling things. And as I got older, and particularly when I was spending my time working at Ferrari, where you had a lot of older cars, that I developed a preference just to go ahead and do things by hand. I prefer to have the feel of what I'm doing. I can tell if the fastener is about to strip or be cross-threaded. And although it's a little bit slower on reassembling things, in the end I found that it's quicker because I'm not dealing with damaged or broken parts or damaged threads. Now you will notice why I'm zipping on the velocity stacks of the engine and the plenum cover. I am using a electric screw gun. One thing that you can't tell here though is that's not an impact gun, that's just a normal screw gun, and I actually have the clutch set to the lowest setting. And then I go back and torque everything. Now I torque the plenum bolts and the velocity stack bolts with my quarter inch torque wrench. And I torqued both of those to about 80 inch pounds, which is about 6 foot-pounds or 9 newton meters. Fun little fact, back when I was still working as a technician for BMW, probably around 2004, I had an E39 M5 come in that had a misfire, and well, long story short, I found that one of the plenum bolts has left loose by the previous shop that worked on it, and the engine sucked it down into the cylinders, and I ended up putting a new block and pistons in that car to get it back on the road. So naturally, I'm very sure that I always have all of my plenum and velocity stack bolts very tight.
As always, guys, thanks for taking the time to watch the channel. Please do check out my other videos. I have more content on this E39 M5, also an E28 that I'm restoring. Appreciate you guys for taking the time. Please drop your comments below, hit the like button, subscribe. Thanks for watching.